Good morning, Sunnyside. Amen. What a blessing it is to be in the house just one more time. Amen, amen. If there are visitors in the house, just do know that we will acknowledge you later on in the services, but welcome. The announcements are as follows. Just be aware then that on the first and second Saturdays of the month at 11 a.m., there will be a youth choir rehearsal. And then the youth programs will begin on the, will start then on the first and the second Saturdays from 12 until 2 p.m. And the adult choir still meets at noon on Saturdays. And you're more than welcome to come and just lend your voice as well. Bible studies are held on Wednesdays at 12 noon. Do feel free to come and join. And don't forget to visit us on the web and Instagram. And remember to like and share the videos and the posts. That is SBC, Sunnyside Baptist Church, SBClove.com. The new discipleship class is going quite well, so don't hesitate to check with Sister Leanna Sims. Okay, or just come in. Just come. Amen. All right, calling all members and friends of Sunnyside, just be aware that the food program continues, and on the Friday leading up to the third Saturday, they will be packaging up the food that is to be distributed, and that is coming up, so be aware of that. Okay, and that Saturday it will be given away. Local businesses are encouraged then to just call the church for additional information about sharing information in the foyer. I'm aware that there are at least 5 homeless student facilities that are available here at Sunnyside. The key words are homeless students, okay? So please do call Sunnyside and get additional information regarding that. At the same time, there are some positions that are available here at $19 an hour. So again, call and get information regarding that as well. In getting ready to close, know that the Los Angeles Public Library is offering a June Jubilee, a celebration of Black excellence. That will take place this Saturday, June the 10th, from 10 until 4 p.m. at the Central Library, located at 630 West 5th Street downtown. And they're offering arts and crafts, children and teens programs. They're offering speakers and workshops on business and financial literacy, genealogy, health and wellness, job and career mentoring assistance, and again, the emphasis is a celebration of Black excellence. Okay, if you like additional information, please call 213-228-7430 or check with me as well. Amen. Thank you.
Amen. Good morning, y'all. I just walked up here and D said, let's go. I feel it. Let's go. Y'all ready to have some church this morning? Come on, y'all. That like God woke you up this morning and gave you breath in your lungs, because God has been good to all of us. And I just want to just thank God for allowing everyone to be here. So as we stand in to recite our call to worship, everyone come in and feel free today. Don't sit down and just watch. I want you to join in and feel the Spirit of God move today. So we ask that everyone, if you can, see the screen. You can also check in your bulletins as we recite our call to worship. And it reads, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within that gate, O Jerusalem, for a day in that courts is better than 1,000. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. Amen. Let's give God some praise.
Amen. Hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. God has seen fit for us to see the beginning of the second half of 2023. Amen? We are in June 2023. 6 months in, and we thank God for all that he has done. Amen. We just want to give him praise, glory, and honor. Oh, give Amen. Thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Trust God today. I'm talking about really, really you trust God. I mean, I know we try to make it happen on our own, and that's okay sometimes, but we got to really, truly, genuinely trust God. Amen.
I will be.
never leave.
I'll never leave you. I'll never leave you. If you will only trust me.
Say trust me. Said, I will fight your battles.
I'll fight your battles.
Is anybody out there believe that? He said, I will fight your battle.
I'll fight your battle.
Come on, sing it with us. Say, I will fight your battle.
I'll fight your battle.
Everybody say, trust me,
trust me, trust me.
God says that say, trust me,
trust me,
trust me.
Trust
can we take
me.
It back? Somebody say, I am that I am,
that I am.
He says, I have all power. Say, trust me.
Trust me.
If you
will only trust me.
Somebody been trying it on their own. Say,
trust me.
When you don't see a way out, say,
trust me.
If you will. Say, trust me,
trust me,
trust me,
trust me.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Good morning, Sunnyside.
Good morning.
My name is Deacon Glover, and I have the opportunity to read the Word of God today. And the Word of God comes to the book of Philippians, the 4th chapter, verses 4 through 7. And it reads as follows. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentle spirit be known to all men. Let the Lord is near. Be anxious for nothing. Because everything is by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Let your request be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all compensations, will guard your hearts and your minds. In Jesus Christ. And may God bless the hearers, readers, doers, preachers, and teachers of his word, and let the church say,
amen.
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 Amen. You can be seated. He leads me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. When you become a believer, your spirit is made right. And sometimes the soul doesn't get the notice. It has a hole in it. Due to things that has happened in the past, hurt, abuse, molestation. But we want to speak to you today and tell you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul.
Yes.
Now, some people's actions are not because of their spirit is wrong, but it's because the past has left a hole in their soul.
Yes. Yes.
Now, may this wisdom help you get over your past and remind you that God could heal the hole in your soul.
Yes.
Now, I have my sister Lisa here. She's going to help me with this wisdom and tell this story. You ready, Lisa? She gonna help me, we're gonna tell this story.
Deliver me, 'cause all I seem to do is hurt me. Lord, deliver me. 'Cause all I seem to do is hurt me.
Yes, sir.
Hurt me.
I know we should be finishing, but we're gonna sing that two more times. Take it up or not.
A
decree. So I'm speaking to all that's listening.
Yes.
Starting here, starting now. Your past won't control your future.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Starting
Thank
now.
Yeah.
This is a new day.
Yes.
This is your exit.
Come on.
You are officially
Come on now.
Released. Now sing it for me.
This is my exodus. This is my exodus.
This is my
exodus.
Good God is.
Hallelujah.
God is amazing.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Starting here, starting
Hallelujah.
Now.
Hallelujah.
We
Hallelujah.
Have been officially released.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
This is our
Thank
effort.
You, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you,
Thank
Jesus.
You, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Come on, drums. Come on, drums. Come on.
Woo. One more time. Everybody say, this is our exodus. Everybody.
This is my.
This is my.
This is my.
Thank you, Jesus, for breaking strongholds today, God. Thank you, Jesus, for breaking chains, God. Hallelujah. Woo. I'm coming out. Somebody got to say, I'm coming out. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
At the name of Jesus, chains are broken.
Thank you,
thank you,
Lord.
Jesus.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, God.
Yeah.
Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
I'm gonna keep that train going, saying thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord, for waking us up this morning, Lord. Thank you for letting us breathe, Lord. Thank you for letting us get here this morning, Lord, without no accidents happening occurring to us, Lord. Lord, I thank you, Lord. Lord, I know what you've done for me, Lord. I'm here because you have thanked me, Lord.
Hallelujah.
You have me live here and let me stay here, Lord. Lord, I thought about March 23rd, 2009, Lord, will you let me survive, Lord, and let me stay here to see what's going on, to take care of my kids, Lord, to be here for this day, Lord, to be here for this day for my son when he's going to graduate coming next week, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I thank you for covering me, Lord. I thank you for covering us all, Lord, this morning, Lord. I thank you, Lord. Lord, I thank you, Lord. Lord. I thank you, Lord. Let's pray for the ones that's not here today, Lord. The ones that couldn't make it this morning, Lord. The ones that's not feeling well this morning, Lord. Cover them in the blood of Jesus, Lord. Lord, just keep us moving, Lord. We're halfway through the year already, Lord. Halfway, Lord. We're 6 months in already, Lord. We thank you, Lord. And that's the only way we're here for this 6 months because of you, Lord. Because you let your angels come over and tap us on the shoulders and wake us up and let us get out there and go this morning, Lord. And let us see what's going on, Lord. Let us take time and just sit down, get in the closet somewhere, and just take minutes, maybe hours, Lord, and just think about you, Lord. Because none of this is possible without you, Lord. None of this is possible, Lord. And I thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Lord, 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 Lord. I thank you, Lord. I'm glad how you're working on me in some ways, Lord. I'm glad how you're working on everybody, Lord. Lord, I pray for people that's having issues at home, that's having trials and tribulations, and Lord, if it wasn't for you, we couldn't get through this, Lord. And you letting us get through this, Lord, and I thank you, Lord. God, I thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Thank Jesus, Jesus, in the name of Jesus, Lord. I'm really so thankful this morning, Lord. I'm so thankful, man. The Spirit is flowing so well in here this morning, Lord. It feels so good, man. It's very bright in here, Lord. We love that, Lord. But we thank you. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, Father. Amen.
Good morning, church. Morning. It is now time for tithes and offering. Please stand and join me. I am reading the offertory scripture, since it's taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, 6 through 8. Ready? Begin. Remember this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give. Not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, you will abound in every good work. Would everyone please remain standing, face the wall, follow the instructions of the ushers. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to give back to you a portion of what you have blessed us with. Bless those who had to give and those who had not to give. We pray that you will bless this offering for the building of your kingdom here on earth. Amen.
Part of the scripture says, surely his goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Amen. Because great is his faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies we see. Our last song speaks of the goodness of God. All of our lives, from the youngest to the oldest, he has been faithful. He has been faithful. Even when we've been faithless, he has been faithful. Even when we can't see him, he's working. Even when we don't feel him, he's working. And I love him. I love you, Lord. never fails me in all my days. I've been held in your hands from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. Oh yes you have. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh I will sing of the goodness of God.
So
morning. Oh, there we are. Good morning. Good morning. My name is Alvin Eddington Jr., for those who don't know me. Pastor said, Alvin, can you preach on this day? I'm like, I can't preach on that day. He said, can you preach on this day? And so I'm here to preach a word because Pastor said he needed a word. I said, Pastor, I was thinking about speaking on the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I was going to talk about that because I know that one pretty well, but he's like, everybody knows that. I said, I was also thinking about be anxious for nothing, but in everything, with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, make your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. He says, stay there. And so as I unpacked why he wanted me to stay here and be anxious for nothing, I had to look at the fact that over the past 2 years in this pandemic, when we came into this pandemic, that most Americans now have risen in their anxiety levels. 25% of Americans who didn't have anxiety before now have anxiety. 25% who weren't depressed before now have depression. So there was something about this pandemic that even when we came out of it, we still ain't right. We can come up in here and in church with our nice bow ties on, and we can look good, and we can act like we all straight in the hood and all that kind of stuff. But the truth of the matter is when we're in behind closed doors, sometimes we have to cry ourselves to sleep. Sometimes we can't show y'all that we crying. As a pastor, as a minister, I can't show you that I am weak and that even though he's made strong, I can't show you that, because if I'm a weak pastor, if I'm a weak black man, then you won't respect me. And so, as we settle into this scripture, I hope that I'm able to impart to you that even though the Bible says to be anxious for nothing, you having anxiety doesn't make you a bad Christian. You having anxiousness doesn't mean there's something wrong with your spirituality. It simply means that you're human. That you are human. And God didn't come to save people who had it all together. So, as was read into your hearing this morning by Brother Boo, he started with rejoice always. Again, I say, rejoice. Rejoice always. Not sometimes, not most times, but rejoice always. Well, okay, that's what the man of God is supposed to say. You're always supposed to have joy in the Lord, right? Well, Paul was in prison when he wrote this letter. And he didn't know if he was going to get out or if he was going to die in prison. If he was going to have life or they won't kill him in prison. He didn't know. That's why he said earlier in the second chapter, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. If I live, I live for y'all, but if I die, I get to be with God. And so he's in prison, not knowing if he's ever going to see these people again. So he's telling them in the middle of his anxiety, in the middle of his fear, in the middle of his frustration, rejoice always. In the Greek, that word rejoice actually means grace. It doesn't just mean just I'm going to have joy and I don't really have joy. The reason why I have joy, the reason why I'm rejoicing is because of the grace of God. It's God's grace that allows me to rejoice even when things are bad. Even when my kids ain't acting right. Even when my boo is acting a little funny. Even when my boss is tripping. Even when I can still rejoice. I can still, because I have God's grace. And can't nobody take God's grace from me. Can't you, the police, the politicians, nobody can take God's grace from me. And since I have his grace, it says, grace always. Again, I say, y'all missed it. Rejoice always. Again, I say, grace always. Again, I say, grace. If you remember, you have the grace of God with you. No matter what you're going through at work, no matter what you're going through in these streets, God's grace got me. My mama may not be able to have me. The homies may not be able to have me. The church people may not be able to have me. But God's grace. Rejoice always. Again, I say what? Rejoice. So remember that. That is really the foundation of your joy. Rejoice always. Again, I say rejoice. The Lord is near. He said, let your gentleness be made known to all. The Lord is near. Let your gentleness be made known to everybody. Not just church folk. You come in here, put on the church face. God is good all the time, and all the time God's good. Walk out them doors and cussing them kids out. Oh man. Oh, if y'all didn't know, now you know. I'm that type of preacher. I'm just somebody that God saved and brought them out and brought them in here, and now I got a word for it. So he says, let your gentleness be made known to all. That word for gentleness in the Greek is fair. So let your fairness be made known to all. If powder cocaine, 5 ounces, gets you 5 years, then 5 ounces of crack cocaine should get you 5 years. That's fair. But y'all know, crack cocaine, 5 ounces, gets you 15 years. 5 ounces of powder cocaine gets you 5 months in rehabilitation, and that's not fairness. God said, y'all not supposed to be like that. Y'all need to always be fair. Why? Because of God's grace. It's God's grace. It's not if they deserve it. Do they deserve the same? They may not deserve it. But God's grace, you don't deserve God's grace. It is unmerited favor, something that you can't earn, something you can't pay for, you can't work it out, you can't do nothing to receive God's grace. It says, let your gentleness be made known to all, the Lord is near. Whatever your situation is, you be gentle with them folks, because God is near. Let me tell y'all something about the big homie, my daddy, God. He can get them better than you can ever get them. You don't have to lay your hands on nobody. He got hands, he got feet, he got a mouthpiece. All God have to do is say, let the sun rise. And that's the God you serve. And if he say, vengeance is mine, says the Lord is near. God got it. You don't have to put your hand in it. You don't have to cuss them out, because God got a tongue on him that is. Let your gentleness be made known to all. The Lord is near. God is near in every situation. So now we're going to jump into the main part of what I want to talk to you guys about. Be anxious for nothing. The reason why I like to look into the Greek and pull out those words and get a full understanding is because we look at that word anxious and we're like, well, because I have some anxiety, because I might have to take some medication for my anxiety, because I worry about stuff, there's something wrong with my spirituality. That word doesn't even mean that. That word means don't be divided. Don't be distracted. So it's saying be distracted by nothing. Don't be distracted by that stuff. I don't care what's going on. I don't care what's going on. Don't be distracted from the purpose I have for you. That is rooted in what? Grace. God saved you through his grace so that you can be saved, so that you can do some kingdom work. Not so that you can get caught up in all that stuff. I don't want you worrying about that. I don't want you distracted by that stuff. Don't be distracted by nothing that's going to get you off the purpose that God has for you. Not the purpose you have for yourself. I'm sorry, I know in America that we believe that our lives belong to us, but your life belongs to God, the one who gave you grace. The one who you're rejoicing in. And the one who's near. And if you want him to get them, then you need to. So he says, don't worry about anything. No, not worry. Don't be distracted. We get so distracted. I don't know how many married people we got in here. Man. I don't know. Be careful. Be careful. Let me see. Be careful. I'm going to be careful. My God is not a careful God. He say what he say. So I'm going to go ahead and walk in the power of God. When they get on your nerves, husbands, because she will. Don't smile, don't look, don't say amen to it. Don't. She will. When she get on your nerves for the 100th time, the Bible tells you, don't get distracted by what's going on the outside of her. Live and learning with your wife and see what's going on the inside of her that's causing her to irritate you. Fix what's on the inside of her, and then you won't be irritated. Husbands, love your wives like Christ loved the church. That's what Christ did. He came out of heaven, and he put on flesh so he can understand mankind. Can't you put on what your wife is going through so you can understand? Wives, you are not absolved. So wives, when he getting on your nerves, because he's going to get on your nerves too. It's going to happen. Wives submitting to your own husbands. When he getting on my nerves, submit to your own husbands. You submit to that pastor down there, he tell you come up to, y'all mad. You submit to your boss. You don't ask him no questions. Your boss say, be there at 8 o'clock, you there at 8 o'clock. Your husband say, he want his meal, that's, we're gonna DoorDash tonight. I'm gonna look over here. But he's getting on my nerves. He don't even go to church. Y'all better read your Bible. First Peter 3, 1 through 6, it says, even if he is a heathen, even if he don't believe the word, that you're, okay, so that's not my sermon, so. Don't get distracted by things and people that you get off the mission and purpose of God. Don't not be a husband or a wife that God has called you to be because you feel like he's hurting your feelings or he's not giving you flowers. Don't do that. Be anxious for nothing but in everything. Every single solitary thing. When he getting on your nerves, pray. When these church folks getting on your nerves, pray. When you getting on your own nerves, pray. It says, be anxious for nothing but in everything with prayer and supplication. So what's the difference between prayer and supplication? I'm glad you asked. Prayer is me talking to God. We just talking. God, you know, how was your day? My day was good. How was your day? It was good because we have a relationship. I don't just talk to God one day on Sunday. I talk to God all the time because we're in a relationship. Now, if I only talk to God one time on Sunday or if I allow somebody else to talk to God, then me and God got some relational problems. So pray to God. Talk to God yourself. Go, hey, what's happening, big homie? How have you? Look, y'all say, oh, that's so sacrilegious. No, he is the big homie. He's the big homie. Above all your, he's the big, if you want to call him big homie, if you want to call him daddy, if you want to call him Jehovah Rapha, if you want to call him Jehovah Nisi, if you want to call him El Elyon, if you want to call him Elohim, if you want to call him the great I am, whatever you want, but call him out and say, hey, I need you. I may not even know your name, but I know I need you. And so you talk to your daddy like you talk to your, I'm just talking to my homie, I'm just talking to my daddy, and I'm letting him know how my day was going. I'm letting him know my needs and my desires and my wants. That's prayer, just talking to God. Supplication is begging God. That's a different type of conversation. If you ain't never been in nothing, you ain't never been desperate enough, you ain't never fell on your knees and cried out to God, you keep living. Then I promise you, God will bring you to your knees. And that's when you beg God, God, get my baby off drugs. God, fix the hood. How many of us are praying for our hoods? How many of us are praying for everything that's going on in the community? You want the government to fix it? The government can't fix it. Have you been praying about what's going on in the hood? Or have you been praying what's going on in your house? Are you begging God? We have to beg God. Just talking to him is cool. We chop it up. But when things are bad, I'm going to chase behind the ambulance so that my baby can get. Are you chasing behind God, who's the only one who can fix it? So it says with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving. That doesn't mean anything is good yet. The situation ain't changed. Your husband's still a knucklehead. Your wife still ain't listening. Them kids still wilding out. The homie's still locked up. Nothing's changed, but I'm thanking God. Why am I thanking God? In that word for thanksgiving also includes grace. Eucharitis is the word. And Eucharitis is like Eucharist. Thanksgiving, but within charis is in the middle of that. Charis is grace. So he's saying, be thankful because of God's grace. Going back to grace always against, I say grace. It all lines up. God's word is so good. And so wait, be thankful, not because of what he did, not even because of what he's doing, not even because of what he's going to do, but because you know he's going to do something. Because he's good like that. It is his grace. I don't know how it's going to look. I don't know when it's going to happen. I don't know how it's going to happen. That ain't my business. I gave it to God. I prayed and I supplicated. I gave it to God. And so now, God, I'm going to thank you. However you fix that thing, however you work that thing out, you got it. And I'm going to stop being worried about it. I'm going to stop having sleepless nights. God don't sleep. It don't make no sense for both of us to be up all night. Oh, some of y'all ain't been up all night. It don't make no sense for me and God to be up all night about something I can't handle that only He can handle. So thank Him in advance. Because God, I have an expectation from You. I expect You to fix it. I expect it. I don't just go to God with, God, you know, I'm just throwing up stuff and I just, no, I don't do that. I'm in a season of my life where I'm like, God, we got to do some big things. You know, I don't serve a little God. Stop, God, You feed my family. And I've never seen the righteous forsaken or seed begging bread. In America, they give you food stamps. Stop playing. I ain't never, why am I asking God for little things that everybody eats? I got to ask God for some big things. Some of y'all have given up on some stuff in life, some people in life, and you don't want to even thank God for them because you don't want God to fix it. You've given up on some people in life that God said don't give up on, and you're tired, and you're sick and tired of being sick and tired because you've been doing it, and you haven't been letting God do it. I'm going to say to you, thank God in advance for their healing. Thank God in advance for the reconciliation. Thank God in advance. He says, with everything, with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, make your request be made known to God. As y'all can see, I sweat like a runaway slave. Make your request. Now, this is the God who knows everything. You got to tell God what you want. Man, God knows everything, so He knows my heart, and He knows, man, God, look. This is what I need. Right now, my mind is going every which way, God. I don't know. I don't understand what's going on with me. I don't understand what's going on with my friends. I don't understand what's going on with my kids. I don't understand what's going on. I don't understand, God. So, God, this is what I need. Tell God what you need. And even if you ask Him for what you want and it's not good for you, He won't give it to you, but He's going to listen. Make your request be made known to God. We have not because we ask not. And when we ask, the Bible says, we ask with the wrong motive. So even when you're praying about certain things, sometimes you're praying about things with the wrong motive. And so make your request. As you're making your request be made known to God, I promise you this, that God will start to then change your prayers. Your prayers will be more or less about you and more about kingdom purpose. And as you start to walk in kingdom purpose, then He'll fix all that other stuff. To seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness and all these other things I'll handle, but are you seeking first the kingdom of God? Make your request be made known to God. The most beautiful part of this to me, now understanding that it's grace on top of grace, on top of grace. I don't have nothing to do with this. So why am I worried? I don't have nothing to do with this. And the peace of God. The peace of God. Not a peace of God, the peace. I don't think we understand that. The peace of God, the shalom of God, it doesn't just mean that things are peaceful around you. It means that when all hell is breaking loose around you, when there's chaos around you, inside of you, can't nobody touch you. That's God's peace. When hell is going on all across America, they're like, why are you not tripping? The peace of God. Why are you not worried about whoop-de-whoop? The peace of God. Why are you not tripping off the homie God? The peace of God. Why are you not? The peace of God. The peace of God. You don't need this drink? The peace of God. You don't need this? The peace of God. It's medicinal. But you don't need... The peace of God that covers your mind, which is your soul, your body, and your spirit. Man, see, my time is fleeting. I don't want to get, man is triune. Man is mind, which is also your soul, body, and spirit, right? When God made man, He made man that way. So God said, I want to give you peace in all capacities of yourself. Not this manufactured peace. Not that I'm walking in work, you doing good, I'm cool, I'm good. How you doing? I'm good. We always tell people we good and we be bad. We be ready to break down. I'm good. No, it's real peace. I got peace. Is your situation changed? No. Why? It's the peace of God. Can't nobody take God's peace from me. Can't nobody take God's peace from me. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding. You can't even understand it. They can't understand it. I don't understand the peace that I have in this season when I should be choking people out, when I should be locked up for shooting or killing somebody. I shouldn't have this peace, but God's grace is greater than my foolishness. And God said, I'm going to give you my grace so that you can have my peace. Don't y'all want God's peace? If you want God's peace, you got to talk to God and beg God, be thankful to God for his grace. And God's peace, which surpasses all understanding, shall guard your heart and minds in Christ Jesus. And I'm done. This word for guard, God shall guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. It's a military word. I didn't have time to unpack this town. It was a military town, a former military town where former soldiers would go and live after they had completed their service. And so God's saying, I'm going to guard your heart. In military terms, it's I'm going to violently protect. Like if you're guarding, where my hood dudes at? When you're guarding the hood and you're on lookout, you violently protecting the hood. God said, I will violently protect your heart and your mind. On, if you just accept the fact that you're walking in my grace and my peace, I will violently protect your heart and your mind. Why does God say he has to protect your heart and your mind? Because your heart and your mind is the thing the devil's after. The reason why people have anxiety issues is because their mind is going crazy. The reason why people are dealing with depression is because of something in their heart. God said, I want to protect you from your mind and your heart, your feelings and your emotions. I want to protect you even from yourself. I will violently protect you. I will violently protect you. That's God saying it. So when God says something, he said, I put that on God. I put that on me. And when God said it, it's done. My encouragement to us on this morning is to let that stuff go, bro. You holding on to stuff that God is violently protecting you from. God said, I'm going to violently protect you from everything that's going to attack your heart and mind. And then what do? You go call up old girl, you know you shouldn't. Okay, you know, man, we try to act like we don't care about women, so I'm going to do it like this. So the woman, you know, God then released you from that situation. And you know he was never any good for you, but you just loved him so much. He took me to Ruth Chris. And he got my nails done, hair done, everything done. And he just loved me. But he was not only verbally abusive, but physically abusive. But he loves me, and I'm not knocking domestic violence because it takes at least 10 times for it to happen before a woman is even thinking about leaving. So it's not about domestic violence and me promoting that. But the reality is you're going to go back to him because emotionally you are attached to him for whatever reason. And now you're more, now you listen to all the songs from the little, you know what I'm saying, your song. Oh, y'all, why do y'all do that? Why? I'm sad and I'm going to go listen to these sad songs. Y'all laughing because y'all know it's true. I think I'm talking to them youngsters, but these older, they be listening to Marvin Gaye, you know what I'm saying? They be like, they want some sexual healing. Oh, I'm not so sad in church. Y'all better stop. And so now you run back where God says, I'm going to protect you. Now you're feeding your spirit, your soul with that stuff. And now you want, why can't I let them go? Stop listening to that stuff. What do I replace it with, preacher? I'm glad you asked. Gospel music is bomb. You don't have to wait to just come to church on Sunday to get you some gospel music. And youngsters, they got gospel, they got hip-hop, some gospel hip-hop that's amazing, that's better than, that's talking about positive things. It's talking about how beautiful and wonderfully made you are, young woman. You don't need none of these knuckleheads, young this and young that, to tell you that you ain't nothing. You are fearfully and wonderfully made in the concept, in the eyes of God. He made you and only you, and your fingerprint has nobody else's fingerprint on it. So you don't have to run around here like Meg and Cardi and look like all these city girls, people who are all, you don't have to do that because God made you fearfully and wonderfully. He didn't make any mistakes. And look, I got daughters. Don't let no little boy tell you otherwise. Anyway, so now in order for you to be emotionally connected, how do I do that to God? You pray and you beg and you replace your thoughts with his thoughts. I don't remember the scripture. I didn't look at it. It was not on the screen. I don't remember it because he's a preacher. I memorized this before I started preaching. I had to. Because me, I deal with depression. And if I don't remind myself of who I am in God,
if I don't remind myself that the Lord is my shepherd, I'm not my shepherd. That woman ain't my shepherd. My finances, if I don't remind myself of what God's word say, I might be out there doing some strange things for some change. And so I have to stand on God's word so that it can inform me of my kingdom equality, that I'm great no matter what the world says I am. Why? Because he fearfully and wonderfully made me. And when God made man, I'm about to drop this on y'all spirit and I'm out of here. When God made man, he decided to make him in Africa. And he decided to make him not only in Africa, he decided to make him out of dirt. He did not only decide to make him out of dirt, he made it mud. So brown dirt turns into mud. So when God decided to make man in his image and in his likeness, he looked like me. So it don't matter what nobody in America says. The reason why they can't tell me nothing about me is that when God said, I'm going to make a man, I'm going to make him look like Alvin Eddington Jr., fearfully and wonderfully made. That's my word for you on today. If you have a song of invitation, don't be anxious for anything. It would be unwise of me not to. I'm going to let the pastor open up the doors to the church, but I got to tell you guys this, that the way to salvation is only to have this relationship with God is through salvation, and that's only through Jesus Christ. It's not through Buddha. I tried it. It's not through Allah. I tried that too. It's not through yourself either. I tried that too. It's through Jesus Christ. And Jesus said, not only do you have to accept them into your heart, but that you have to also be baptized into the watery grave of baptism, come up anew in the newness of life, and the Holy Spirit of God will now never leave you nor forsake you, ever, no matter what you get into, no matter whose bed you just got out of. The Holy Spirit said, I will not leave you. I love you that much. And if you want that, if you want that salvation, you want this peace that surpasses all understanding, you got to get to a relationship with Jesus Christ. Yes. Die to you and say yes to him. Yes. And I'll turn it over to the pastor. What the hell? Oh, he just want me to keep. So if there's anyone who needs prayer, so that's for those who don't know Jesus, right? But if you know him, and you're like, man, I've been struggling with anxiety myself, but I didn't want people to know. I've been dealing with some emotional and some mental health issues. I didn't want anybody to know because I feel like I'm not a good Christian and I should have it all figured out. Paul had emotional distress. In 2 Corinthians, in the first chapter, Paul said, I despaired even of life. And when you unpack that, he said, I didn't even want to live anymore. This is the great Paul, 13 books of the New Testament. We preach his sermons all. He said he had some emotional issues and he didn't want to live anymore. But guess what? He kept fighting. It's okay to go through things. God didn't come for those who didn't need healing. God came. Is there more? God came for those who were hurt. The church is a hospital. The church is a hospital. It's not an entertainment center. It's a hospital for those who are sick. And if you're sick on today, come on down. We're going to pray for you. You tell us your needs. We're going to pray for you. We're going to pray with you. Because our God is a healing God. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything with prayer. With prayer, my house shall be called a house of prayer. It don't matter who's watching. It don't matter who's not watching. What is God saying to you right now? Right now, God is saying, come to me. All you are heavy laden and burdened, and I shall give you rest. Take on my yoke, because my yoke is easy and my burden is light. If you want to have this relationship with God, if you want prayer, come down. Don't worry about your friends today. Don't worry about what your grandmama gonna say. Don't worry about what the next person next to you gonna say. God has something for you. He has something for you, and God desires to have an intimate relationship with you. We may pray for you today, but on Monday, you can pray for yourself. On Tuesday, you can pray for yourself. On Wednesday, I can pray for myself. On Thursday, you can pray for yourself. Come on down. Is there more? Don't worry about nothing, nobody else. This altar is full with people who are willing to be real about the fact that I don't have it all together. As a matter of fact, I need to be prayed for. I preach this sermon, but I preach even in my season of depression and anxiety. I still got to give a word of God because it's not about me. It's about him. I'm going to pray for us generally. Is there anybody else? And if you just want to raise your hand, you don't want to come down, just raise your hand.
Just raise your hand. God knows. Beloved Father, we come before you. Father, we're thankful. We're thanking you in advance. Not because of who we are, but because of who you are. We thank you right now for healing, for deliverance. We don't want to just sing about songs of deliverance. We want to walk in your deliverance. We don't want to just sing songs about healing. We want to walk in the fact that we are healed. By your stripes, we are healed. If it's mental, physical, emotional, God, we bring it all to the altar. We lay it at your feet. We don't want to hold on to this stuff anymore. If it's our kids, if it's our finances, if it's our family, God, you take it. These are your kids. These are your finances. This is your family, God. So we give it all to you, dear God. We don't hold on to nothing, but we give you everything. It's in Jesus' mighty name, under his authority, we declare these things done. Amen, amen, and amen.
Amen. Let's give God some glory. Give God some glory. Did he deliver you? Do you believe it? Do you believe the word? Do you believe the word? Amen. Of those that are here, never is there anyone here that came to accept Christ? Is there anyone up here that came to accept Christ for the first time? Come on, sis. Come on, sis.
To the high.
Is there anyone else?
Yes.
Amen. Yes. You see, you can't even hardly understand what the preacher said unless you become a child of God. And the Spirit tugging at some of your hearts, you got to make a difference. But you can't do it on your own. God has to come in and change you. Some of us didn't get saved in a church. Some of us got saved in a graveyard, in the bathroom, in a restaurant. But when the Spirit of God talks, you better move. Amen? Amen. So I ask one last time, is there anybody else? Amen. Amen. Now, the preacher prayed. And now we're going to go into something that, if all of you are believers, that Jesus Christ died on the cross for you. You believe that? Do you believe that?
Yes.
Do you believe he suffered and died, took away your sins, washed you, and made you whole again? If you believe that, return to your seats rejoicing, because we're going to do it in remembrance of him. Amen. Little sister, we'll talk to you after church, okay? Come up after church. Thank you now. See, you don't just get saved. We got to give you some material, some Bible. So what the preacher was talking about, you pray to God, you talk to him, you make your supplementation to him. But ain't nothing like reading that scripture and opening the Bible to something you needed to hear. Just like I need to hear that word today. Amen. Amen.
We're going to take this moment to prepare our hearts for communion. The word of God says on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and first he gave thanks and then he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. And whenever you do this in remembrance of me."
Amen. And on that same night,
he took the cup and he said, "In this cup is the new covenant, my blood, which I have shed for you." And he says, "As often as you drink this and as often as you eat, do this in remembrance of me."
Amen. He said, "Do it in remembrance of me and what I've done for you." He did it so you didn't have to. Amen? So this day, let us eat and drink in remembrance of him.
Today, you will never
Now, before we get to the power, I want to take us back to the cross. Because it was at the cross, where we first saw the light, where we saw the burdens of our sins. We saw ourselves. It was there. Help me, choir. I want to ask you a question. Do you remember where you were when you first accepted him? When the burdens of your life and you realize that I need Jesus. I need to go to my father. I'm like the prodigal son or prodigal daughter. I need to go back home. Do you remember that day, that night, that hour, and where you were? Now sing it like you remember the day. A moment. Don't you feel the Holy Ghost up in here? Oh, Lord Jesus. Come on, Lord. Come on, Holy Ghost. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you. As he gave his body, This wafer represents the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who died for us because we couldn't die for ourselves. Take, eat, and remember what he did for you. Amen. Let us eat. And in the same manner, he took the cup, saying, "This is my blood that I'm shedding for you. The thorns in my head, the spear in my side, the beating that I took, I did it for you. So that when you sin, you plead the blood of Jesus." Now unto him, let us drink together. As brothers and sisters in Christ, let us drink together. Amen. Come on, something. Blood is fine. The blood is fine. Come on. Now we can sing about that blood. That power, working blood. That power that gives us strength that we can't do for ourselves.
Power. Wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb.
You want to sing it again? This time, remember the situation that you called on the power. This time, remember the situation when you was in that dark place. This time, remember when nobody could help you but God. What did you call on? Power's working power.
In the precious blood of the Lamb. There is power.
Come on, you can stand up.
Just for a minute, amen. Just for a minute. I'd like to recognize our visitors today before we end church. Any visitors, just raise your hand, please. Amen. Come on now. Yes, yes. Would you like to introduce yourself, please?
Hello, everybody. I'm Ari. I'm here with Adam. Thank y'all for having me.
Amen. Adam, my brother up there, no stranger to the church. He ain't either.
I'm not a visitor. That is my brother up there, my brother who run the word. God is good. God is good. I bring you greetings from the Jordan family from in North Carolina, in South Carolina. And I am well pleased with the things that God has done in my life and the rest of the life. Everybody's here because we all here today. But I got big props to give to my little homeboy right there who run the word today, man. I mean, I'm telling you, when I tell you God is good, I got to stand up and tell you, God is good. Me and this brother come from a long ways, and me, I made it to the streets. He was trying to get there, but me and the homies was like, nah, you can't come, bro. You got to go the other way. And look where he is today, and I'm so thankful for the Lord, man. Give him a round of applause, man, for what he's done. And also to my big brother Dyke, oh my goodness, you talking about prayer. He's part of the prayer warrior team that I'm standing here today since I was a little boy. Dyke has been praying for me with my mom and brothers and sisters, and I thank you, big bro. Also, last time I was here speaking, I think it was a year ago when I told you guys I was coming up on an anniversary. On the 18th of this month will be my second sober anniversary, man. So prayer, prayer, prayer does work. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Yeah, so when y'all think that it can't happen, you better do what the prayer preacher said. Get on your knees and pray and beg. And that's what I did, and I'm standing right here with my little homie who just brought the word today. God is good. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Yeah, that there's a gas station salvation. He was in the gas station. Amen. Hallelujah. Won't he do it anywhere? Anymore? I'm sorry. Go ahead, my dear.
Hey, y'all.
Hey, y'all.
Okay, yeah, I'm Sunnyside, and I'm here with Carmen, because she brought me in Kiara.
Carmen and Kiara. Kiara, stand up, Kiara. Okay, where's Sean? Sean, back on the door. I wish we had a picture to show you. They showed me their picture. They went to the prom together. Okay. I didn't recognize neither one of them. Hollywood. Amen.
How y'all doing? My name is Isaiah. I was walking up the street. The lady said, come. So I just came to check it out.
Good morning. My name is Joseph. I'm here with a friend today. God bless everybody. Thank y'all for having us today. Thank
you know, the Spirit draws people. The Spirit, you think you was just walking. Last few Sundays ago, brother was just walking. He had been kicked out of the situation he was in with his suitcase. And my sister back there told him, why don't you come on in church? He's from Chicago. He didn't have anywhere to go. So those new homeless containers we have in the back, they weren't approved yet, but he was the first one to stay in them. And my wonderful, smiling, dear sister, the Holy Ghost is all over you. Introduce yourself.
Good morning, Sunnyside. My name is Beverly Boxy, and every chance I get, I try and come and visit with you because I always get a blessing. And I'm a daughter, mother, grandmother of Justin and Demetra.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you for having me.
Amen. Amen. Now you know I got to introduce her every time she comes, my baby sister back there. Amen. With Dominique's little Micah. Amen. Just wave your hand. Amen. We thank God for this service. Come on up here, my brother. You know, I've been dealing with anxiety, depression, a whole lot of things they told me. Your sermon was for me. Rejoice in the Lord always. See, some of y'all living blindly. You not seeing what's happening out here. I had two funerals this week. Not one, two funerals. And it's hard. And the second one, you knew him. Some of you knew Sonia Wright's son. Shot down in the alley on Western and 92nd. Sean, Kim. We Christians better wake up. God called you for something. Even if it's for giving a loaf of bread to somebody. A mother who don't know how to be a mother. A man who, a little boy who thinks he a man and he don't know how to wipe his nose. Something you can do. Well, I'm not going to stress no more. I'm going to rejoice.
Amen.
Because it ain't my problem. Get us out of here, boy.
If we can be standing so we can be dismissed. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or think, according to the power that works within us, to him be glory forever and ever. Amen, amen, and amen. Have a great day, Sunnyside.
Greet your brother and sisters in the name of Jesus. Thank you, musicians. You did it today. Hello, hello, hello. We had mental health this week, and we have a lot of sandwiches in boxes downstairs. If anyone would like a box with, they have roast beef, vegetarian, turkey, box sandwiches, let us know. We also have sanitized material. Amen.